I am the resurrection and the life. Do you believe this? We just heard 45 verses from the 11th chapter of John's Gospel. But this verse, the 25th, is the only one that I want you to take away today. I am the resurrection and the life. So if someone asks you what the sermon was about, you should just say, Jesus is the resurrection and the life, and you will have gotten the point. Frankly, I don't have much to add to that. But I hope to make a few observations that make this revelation relevant and that might reveal the profundity of what Jesus is saying to us. What does it mean when Jesus says, I am the resurrection and the life? This is the fifth of his I am statements in the Gospel of John. We have already heard him say, I am the bread of the life. I am the bread of life. I am the light of the world. I am the door. And I am the good shepherd. In each of these cases, it sometimes helps to make them personal. When we make Jesus personal, it is often easier to put flesh on what he is trying to say to us, so that we can identify where Jesus is showing up in our lives. So when Jesus says, I am the bread of life, try saying, I am Tyler's bread of life. Or I am Heidi's light of the world. Or I am Grace's door. Or I am Hatley's good shepherd. Ask yourself, what is it in your life that really feeds you? What gives your life joy and purpose and courage? What are those things? Who are those people who really feed your soul? If something pops into your head, that right there is what we Christians call the bread of life. And that's Jesus showing up in your life. Now we can do the same thing with this fifth I am statement. Imagine Jesus saying, I am your resurrection, and I am your life. And this might help us to think of a time in our life when we have experienced resurrection. Very few, in fact, I've never encountered someone who has come to Christ because they've understood him. We need to reconcile our brains to our hearts, but we don't believe in Christ, have trust in him, because cognitively it makes sense to us. We believe in Christ because we've experienced Christ. We trust in that experience. But in order to experience resurrection, we have to have had an experience of death. Have you ever had an experience of being humiliated, betrayed, or devastated by failure or loss? Perhaps a broken relationship, a divorce, an estranged child, a tragic death, a terminal illness, maybe loss of employment, or failing to achieve a long-held ambition. Have you ever been so hurt, emotionally, physically, or spiritually, that the pain caused you just to contract into a ball and hope that it went away? I'm a relatively young man, but I can think of at least two times in my life when I've experienced this kind of pain, and I imagine that many of you sitting up here can think of some kind of experience in your life in which that makes sense. This is the kind of pain that Ezekiel is talking about in our Old Testament reading from today, known as the Valley of Dry Bones. The Jewish people were conquered by Babylon. They were massacred, humiliated, and exiled to a foreign land. Many of their children were killed or left behind, and everything they knew and loved was far away. And the people of Israel cried out in our reading, our bones are dried up and our hope is lost. We are completely cut off. Can you hear them contracting in pain, receding from the world? Resurrection comes after death, and we can ask ourselves, if you have experienced this, What was it that allowed yourself to uncurl from that ball of pain? What was it that allowed you to try again? To get out of bed? Perhaps the better question would be, who was it? Who helped you decide that it was okay to live again, even though you knew that your life would not be the same? Whatever it was, whoever it was, that is what we Christians call resurrection. And that is Jesus showing up in your life. In Ezekiel's words, God will cause breath to enter you, and you shall live. God will lay sinews on you and will cause flesh to come upon you and cover you with skin and put breath in you, and you shall live. Just as our flesh stitches itself back together after being sliced open, so too do our souls heal by the grace of God. Ezekiel says to the Jews, you shall live. And this is just what Jesus is telling us. You shall live. He calls to Lazarus, come out. You shall live. I am life and I am with you. And he calls to us when we are devastated and lost and in pain. You shall live. Do you believe this? That's the question that Jesus asks Martha. And although she says that she does, it is clear that she does not. Martha and Mary both query Jesus, if you had been here, Jesus, my brother would not have died. Clinging to what they have lost, they are weeping and mourning, going to his tomb to mourn there. In a complete reversal of Jesus calling his disciples, come and see life, Mary and Martha tell Jesus, come and see death. Unwilling to uncurl from that ball of pain, they call Jesus to the tomb, expecting him to mourn and weep. And this is why Jesus raises Lazarus, to show us that not even death can overcome the saving power of God's life. The miracle here, which is not a word that John ever uses, isn't the bodily resurrection of a Palestinian Jew 2,000 years ago. The miracle is the gift of life that Jesus is offering Martha and Mary and everyone present, and even us right here in this church. The miracle of a life which cannot be overcome by grief and sorrow and pain and suffering, even death. And this is a big one because we humans are terrified of death. Almost everything we do in our lives happens in the shadow of this fear. We desperately want to make meaning in our lives. We want to do something important. We want to change the world because we're terrified that if we're lucky, these 80 to 90 years are all that we have. And so we talk about our legacy as if this is what matters because it's all we've got because death is coming. There's a certain baseline level of anxiety that you can sense when we, all of us, me included, talk about that. Our legacy. What are people going to think of us? Our popularity. And Jesus is saying, you don't have to think in the short term. You don't have to invest in just 80 to 90 years. That 401k portfolio isn't just tapping out for your retirement. You need to invest in the millennium. You can plant sequoias. You can build cathedrals. You can have children and grandchildren, and you can celebrate the fact that they're going to live lives much longer than you, and you'll never harvest that fruit. But it's okay, because death is not the end, and you don't have to be afraid of it. We can live our lives as if they will never be taken away from us. And when and if we do that, we taste the life of Christ. And that's what Jesus means when he says, I am the life. Perhaps you've had an experience like this, where you throw all caution to the wind and you plant a seed that you will never see the fruit of. And when you do that, you experience the life of God. It is a life that can never be taken away from you. It is a constant flow of energy, of self-offering love that was here before you and will be after you. And we participate in it through grace. And it's bigger than us. When we let go of our control and our fear and our mourning, when we dare to uncurl from that ball of pain and terror about our looming deaths, there Jesus is saying, come out. And we are given an opportunity in Christ to live our lives just this way. In fact, this is the eternal life that all of us were intended to live by God. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. Everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this?